All right. Well, thank you all. Those were all stimulating, although Irvin's was no doubt the most uplifting of the presentations that we heard this morning. So my first question is for the other three panelists to recite their favorite poem. And while you're thinking about that, the tricky part about my job, based on what's been said this morning, is there are about 16 different levels on which I could start asking questions, from the most geeky granular to the most sort of high-level political. And I'm not sure where to start. And so I may sort of end up bouncing around. So forgive me if there's no coherence to the questions I'm asking. In the meantime, all of you, start thinking about what questions you'd like to ask these folks. The first thing, which is a little bit more on the technical side, but you could listen to this presentation and it sounds like everybody's on the same page, we're all together, we all agree. I think we all know the world doesn't quite work that way, so I'm going to ask Wanda and Sandy to put on their to put on hats that try to sort of get outside of that frame for a second and just sort of identify what are the key, the top two or three things that really differentiate the Smarter Balance from the PARC consortia. So I don't know who wants to go first, and you don't have to criticize the other. This is not about sort of being critical necessarily, but really highlighting those things that are different between the two approaches. Wanda, why don't you go first? You're writing notes. You shouldn't have done that.
I think that the key difference really right now is the adaptive testing. I think that that was something that we committed to in Smarter Balance from the very, very beginning.
And could you just define adaptive testing for everyone?
Adaptive testing where a student goes on to, it's online. The student will go on, start answering the questions that are presented to them at the grade level, aligned to the standard. If the question is too difficult, it will give them a less difficult question, not dropping them a whole grade level, but just a less difficult question. If they answer the question correctly, then it gives them a more challenging question. What it does is it actually changes what we're required to do right now by the Department of Ed is measure grade level only. This will allow a student to show where what they really know and not be within just their grade level. So if they're a third grader taking this test, but they can do fifth grade questions, it'll bump them up to fifth grade. Or if they're struggling, it will show them that they're really performing at a lower level. So I think that that's probably the key difference in the two. I think another difference would be that the within course assessments along the way are really a local decision, as opposed to what I think PARC is. It's part of their required system. But I may be wrong. So there's the two things that I think are the difference.
Yeah, I was going to just touch on the second one, which is, I think we both think it's important to have assessments throughout the year, but it is true that the PARC assessments throughout the year, the through course tests, are actually rolled up into a summative score. So, you know, one complaint about testing now is if you have a kid who has a bad day in May and that's it. But the through course assessments will each have a different weight, so 25%, 10%, it'll all roll up into a summative score. And they will be, they're not formative assessments. They actually are part of the summative assessment score, even though they probably look like formative assessments through the year. So I think that is a fundamental difference.
So let me just follow up on both of those. Let me start with Sandy's last point about the through assessments and ask Irvin this question. So let's say it's late November or something like that. There's an assessment. It's because we're part of the PARC consortium, and there's an assessment that's coming in, November, end of late November or something, and it counts. Mm-hmm. And you're the principal of a school in Boston, and there's an accountability system, and you could lose your job, and who knows what might happen. It's all horrible, but here you are. You've got kids, and let's call it a middle school. They're in their first year at your school. A bunch of them, it may be their first year in school in Boston or in America. How is this dynamic of having a high stakes, although partial, assessment occurring so early in the school year?
So it is a challenge, but one of the things that I would say is we do have assessments happening now, right? Early in the school year. So we do diagnostic assessment early in the school year to assess, depending upon the grade. Did you say fourth grade? You didn't give me a grade.
Middle school. Sixth grade. Let's say middle school.
So depending upon the grade, we do diagnostic assessments early on. A principal wouldn't be surprised or wouldn't be new to him to have an assessment. What might be a little bit of a challenge is the fact that this assessment now counts, right? In some ways, this assessment contributes to the student's sort of ultimate performance level. I think it's one of the challenges that we would have as a district is communicating and setting up professional development opportunities for teachers and principals to help them understand that although it may count, and we're still learning to what degree it might count, it really is about what we said earlier, right? It's about continuous improvement. So that's more of a sort of communication strategy on the part of the system. It's making sure that we have enough professional development to make sure that they understand, both teachers and principals, that what we're hoping to get from this is an opportunity for teachers to know what students need to know and where they need to improve continuously.
Are you worried? Sorry, go ahead.
I was going to just pick up on that point. I think that's exactly what the hope of PARC is, that early assessment that does count will actually set the tone for the rest of the year about what matters, about what really matters, which is really authentic, real performance, right? Being able to write, like Irvin talked about, being able to do math problems, being able to show that you can do those things. So part of the reason for that early test is to really sort of set the tone for the rest of the year. But to your point, Jim, I think in the proposal, you know, the proposal's like this big, but I think that first test for the beginning of the year counts like 10%. It's not for all the reasons you said before. We think it's an important thing to start and get the year started off right. But, of course, that's the one that would, you know, sort of count the least for the reasons that you mentioned.
Right. And Wanda and Mike, do you want to weigh in on that in particular?
Yeah, I just one thing to raise, and I worry about saying this in front of a group of educators, you might get really excited, is that, you know, it's not clear that what counting means today is what it's going to mean 3 or 4 years from now. I mean, there's a lot of interest in Washington, certainly, in stepping back, at least at the federal level, from this tough accountability for all schools. There's a lot of talk of saying, hey, we're going to focus like a laser on the lowest performing schools, but that some of this pressure, AYP and all the rest for all schools, needs to go away. At least leave it then to the states to decide what accountability looks like at the state level. So it could be that we may end up moving to more rigorous expectations and greater transparency around how kids are really doing, but in some ways that the stakes might be a little bit lessened, that there won't be quite the same fear that schools are going to be intervened in or be labeled in punitive ways to the same degree that they are now. That's just one of these unknowns as the policy debate continues and shifts around.
But just not to dispute that point, especially at the federal level, but at a local level, we're seeing more use of assessment data to drive teacher evaluation, to drive accountability systems that lead to receiverships and takeovers of schools. I mean, actually, it may be that things are moving in two opposite directions at the same time. Wanda, in terms of the adaptive part of the assessment, so and this may just be a sort of a psychometrician magic answer, but to what extent can you ensure that you're getting comparable data from students who are effectively taking different tests? And how does that relate to things like growth measures and other sorts of things that are sort of increasingly the focus of the way in which we evaluate both student progress but also school improvement?
That is a psychometrician answer, not a psychometrician. Charlie. But there's been enough, I think, adaptive testing. There's been some states are already doing adaptive testing. They've had to do it within grade level. And then I think I think some of your schools in Massachusetts also use the NWEA. That is also adaptive. But I'm not a psychometrician, so I can't tell you all the things. When you said that you're going to ask some geeky questions, I get worried. But I think that what it does give a teacher in 2 weeks is to see, because students can take it twice in that 12-week period. So if a student doesn't do real well on that first one, the teacher can zero in and focus on what it's where the problems are, the challenges are for that student, and really focus in so that when the student takes it again.
But this may be either too geeky or just there's no answer for it quite yet, but a lot of what is a lot of what assessments are used for beyond the sort of diagnostic feedback kind of purpose is to evaluate how schools are doing. Right. And that's one reason why tests are administered on the same day at the same time and in the same form. So that you're literally getting at least the same snapshot. Whether it's accurate or not is a whole different story. But if, for example, students can retake tests, are those tests likely to be, how are they likely to be sort of merged all together to produce some kind of index that tells you how a school is doing?
Well, I do think that they do, there's extensive work done on equating, and I don't know all that's behind it, but I'll give an example of what we do right now in Maine is that we have two opportunities for a student to take the SAT. The SAT is our high school assessment. They can take the SAT on the May administration or the June administration. And then the equating process that goes on says that we can, and then those scores in that school are aggregated up to be the school score. So I know there's psychometricians in this group, and so that's about where my knowledge goes.
So one other in this sort of I think in the same category of topic here, one other question that we wrestled with a little bit in Massachusetts, but I think is sort of brought to mind by the conversation that we've had this morning, is the extent to which we may be trying to do too much with these assessments. So, it's not just a matter of benchmarking the performance of one school against another, one state against another, but we're, so it's of the common yardstick, essentially, that we're trying to create. But it's also about raising standards to college and career readiness. It's about richer diagnostic data, more timely data, computer-based or adaptive assessments, or more sort of flexible assessment environments, creating instructional supports. It's sort of the whole thing. I guess I would ask whether, and I think I know the answer to it because you all are engaged in the work, but whether you have some doubts or questions about whether we're trying to do too much too fast, and if so, whether there's one or two elements of this that are absolutely critical to get right, and the other parts that may go beyond the 2014-15 timeframe. Any response or thoughts?
Yeah, I think it's just important to think of this as a process and not an event, and that in my own view, what's going to drive everything like it has in the last couple of decades are going to be the tests, right? And that when schools are going to really start paying attention to alignment and getting curricular materials ready and getting trained is when all of a sudden they're going to say, wow, okay, this new test is coming and it's going to count. And so I think we're in a bit of a transition period right now. People are learning about the standards and getting to know them, and perhaps there's some alignment going, but I think you're going to really see the pedal to the metal happen once these assessments are out there.
I would just add to that. I mean, sort of on a at the ground level, right? The ground level is classrooms. What happens in classrooms? What happens in schools? And to a lesser extent, what happens in districts? And so your point is very well taken. I think it behooves us as educators to be very thoughtful about two words: coherence and alignment. So the Common Core State Standards and the PARC assessments and Smarter Balance are not happening in isolation. What happens in schools will have to be aligned to that. What happens in districts will have to be aligned with that. The superintendent has an acceleration agenda in Boston Public Schools that has multiple initiatives tied to it. Our responsibility becomes, how do we ensure that the Common Core State Standards is envisioned and seen by practitioners, both principals and teachers, as aligned to that acceleration agenda and not viewed as something separate from it or opposing to it? Because to the extent that we we are unsuccessful at aligning it and developing coherence with what's happening, then people will see it as multiple initiatives, and people will say this is just one more thing, and teachers will say it's just one more assessment, and so that becomes one of our challenges.
Sure. I was just going to say, I mean, remember the last slide that I showed that had all of the challenges? Those are all really real challenges. And I think, you know, it's implementation, it's the technology, it's, I think, the way that both of the consortia are really pushing the assessment field. I think our goal and our visions are much clearer than what we know about what the fields can deliver. But I think this is, really important moment in time where we, maybe for the first time in a very long time, and both Mike and Irwin talked about this, have some focus, right? We have 45 states that have signed on to the same set of standards. We have tons of districts, and Boston's a great example, who are really working hard to implement those standards, are already doing professional development. There's a lot of good work going on. So if we can stay focused and do what we can to develop assessments that are really aligned to those standards, which will have to look like, I mean, if we do a good job over the next couple of years, those assessments will look very different than anything that's currently being given. I mean, if what we end up doing is something that's slightly better than the best summative assessment out there, we're going to be really disappointed. Can we deliver? That's a great question. We're working really hard to deliver because I think this is a really important moment in time, and we have a real opportunity here to do something very different and potentially transformational. And I think Wanda would say the same thing, and we don't say that lightly. I mean, I just think there's a special moment in time to really make good use of those funds to develop assessments that we can all get behind and maybe move past kind of currently what people think about tests, you know, that these actually look different and are accepted because they actually help kids get to where they need to be.
Yes, Wanda.
And I think one of the things that I feel that is so much, such an opportunity here is that every state, and I'm at assessments on my team at the department in Maine, we are all developing assessments that are summative. And we have not really, we've had to put aside assessments that are formative and interim, and we've just left that up to schools to do. Now we have, 45 states plus the District of Columbia and some islands, I think, that are all adopted the same standards. And both of the consortia have the formative assessment as a key component. We have interim assessments in there. There are states that have spent $90 million on just their summative assessment, and now we've both been given 170-ish to develop an assessment that in my mind says, well, if 30 states are developing an assessment, then it's going to cost more than $90 million. But we're all contributing, and I think that the consortia, the way that the states are working, and I only go to our meetings, obviously, but everybody's saying, well, here's what I can contribute. Here's what I'm doing, and I'll put this in the pool. And so people are bringing together resources, and it's not hundreds of millions of dollars right now that are going in every single state that we have to keep doing until 2014, 2015. So right now we're kind of going along this double track.
So here's my last question. In Massachusetts, one of the things that has set our reform effort apart from other places, and I think in some respects at least has helped to drive the results that we've seen, is the high school graduation requirement tied to MCAS. Is there any reason to believe that that policy is at risk to the extent that Massachusetts adopts a new assessment that is grounded in this sort of national consortia or multi-state consortia? So in other words, may there be some rules of practice for the uses of these assessments that may preclude their use in a high-stakes graduation assessment, or because of the nature of their structure at the high school level may make it impractical to do so? Any thoughts about that?
We actually, when we had our all the states that signed on to Smarter Balance had an MOU that the university systems signed on to, and I think that was in both.
Yes.
And one of the items in that memorandum of understanding that our university signed on to, and in Maine they all signed on, was that they would use the assessment from Smarter Balance, that assessment in 2014, in some way in their systems. So will it become the admissions test to say students are ready? We're hoping that it becomes, it's given in the 11th grade. You got 12th grade to remediate. You're not remediating at the university level or at the community college level. So all of our community college system and our higher ed all signed on to use the assessment in some way. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure if it's admissions or placement.
Right. Same. Now, but. Yeah, that's the same for us. We have, I think for the Park State, it's been very clear that decisions about how the tests are used for accountability purposes are really state decisions. And, you know, a number of states have high-stakes exit exams currently. Other states have not high-stakes exit exams but require have course requirements, which Massachusetts doesn't. So states really do this in a, you know, kind of variety of ways to make sure that standards, courses, assessments, accountability all kind of line up together. So we have been very clear that that's a state decision. And I certainly haven't heard anything that would preclude states from continuing with that policy if mm-hmm. they choose to do so. I mean, as the tests get developed there, that may be an active area of discussion. I could see that might be the case, but not yet.
Okay. So let me open it up to anyone in the audience. There are microphones, I believe. Who's got a microphone? There we go. So how about right here? And then from here on out, you can choose who gets to ask the question, so I'm off the hook.
Thank you. I'm Eileen Lee from Math for America, and I have a question for Sandra. Regarding the 11th grade college and career readiness test, well, first of all, am I right that through grade 8 there are the interim or through course, but after that the only high school test is this 11th grade college and career readiness?
Actually, I think that's still under discussion. And I think another thing that's still under discussion is whether there should be end of course exams in high school or whether there should be one exam, how the through courses work in high school. The high school piece of it is still under discussion.
Okay, my question about the 11th grade college and career readiness test is, since in 11th grade kids are taking different courses, and I should say I'm interested in the math side. So in yeah. math, whether it's in algebra, geometry, or other, they're all over. How far back does the test go? Is it just on content through algebra 1, 2, and geometry, or is there arithmetic? Does it go back to 6th grade? What's going on that discussion?
Those are all this is the same answer Wanda's going to have for tests. Those are all under the design of the tests is under active consideration. So I don't have, if we had the discussion in a year, I probably would have sample items to show you, even for high school assessments. So I don't know the answer to that question yet. Part of what I think you're getting at is really true kids take Algebra 1, Geometry, Algebra 2, or an integrated sequence at different times. So there's an active discussion underway about end of course exams for that very reason. Also, back to Wanda's point about college readiness, I think there's a real question. If you've got a kid who finishes Algebra 2 in 10th grade, then what? Let's say they hit the college ready mark early, then what's required to keep their, you know, check mark because your higher ed system has said, yes, we think you're ready for credit-bearing work. Anyway, there are lots of discussions, particularly on the math side, because course sequence is so different and when kids take courses is so different. But the Common Core, the math standards in Common Core essentially get you through a third year of math, which includes it's way more than 1 year of algebra, so it could look like algebra 2, but there's also, as you know, if you've looked at the standards, a lot of data statistics analysis. Anyway, so active question about whether there are three end of course exams over the course of high school, something summative, how far back it goes. So stay tuned.
I'm Gary Kaplan with JF Wynette. I have a four-part question, but it's very tightly linked. Part A, it sounds like all of the new testing is going to be online. Is that correct? Part B, some of the existing testing regimens that are in use now, like MBAE, ANET, Galileo, what happens to them? Do they get superseded by the new methods? Question three, or rather part C. I'll try to be consistent. At the college readiness end of it, right now the test is the Accuplacer. Nobody's mentioned that today. What becomes of the Accuplacer? And then question four, part D, the new curriculum that will get developed to respond to these new standards, how much of that is expected to be online?
Okay, the answer to A is yes, the goal is for the testing to be online. Obviously, lots of challenges with that, but that is certainly the goal for the PARC consortia. I don't know what happens to the current things you're currently doing. Remember, the college readiness score that will occur in 11th grade is just that, an indication that the higher ed institutions in the state will use and will communicate back to students that you're in fact ready for college level work, because kids will have taken all kinds of different math to maybe get there. There may still be a need for placement exams once you get to college to figure out whether that's calculus, pre-calculus, statistics, you know, whatever. So I think that's a decision for higher ed to make. Did I miss a part?
Curriculum.
I think, no, that was the Accuplacer answer. On curriculum, I think everything that we develop will be online. It'll be open source. Anything we develop, anything Smarter Balance develops, frankly, anything the states develop under Race to the Top grants, all wide open, available to everybody, available to all schools, all districts, all states. That was part of taking the federal money.
I would just say, from a district perspective, there's both an opportunity and a challenge with the online focus, right? So we've got 100 and some schools in Boston Public Schools, 56,000 students, and the infrastructure to support online assessment for all 56,000 students has to be built. And so that's sort of parallel work that must happen. We believe this is the direction we should be going in, so we're excited about it, but it does present a challenge making sure that we can do that by 2014.
I'll respond a little bit to the Accuplacer, because we do use a test we use the SAT. So, of course, the question is, what happens to the SAT now as well? And I will say that in our communications with the College Board, they are trying to figure out where they're going to fit in all of this as well. And by doing the Accuplacer, our community college system all uses the Accuplacer, some for admissions and all of them for placement. And they will, they're trying to figure that out too. It's going to depend on how the test gets decided. They're going to use this assessment, the Smarter Balance assessment, in the end. So that's a combination. Well, they have been with us because they're our assessment vendor, but I know that they're all working very hard. They're working very hard at trying to figure out where they'll fit. They could, for us, they could apply, and I'm sure for you, they could apply to be the vendor to develop. So that's wide open as to who will be our vendors that will actually develop the assessments.
We don't have relationships with vendors yet. No RFPs have gone out, and we actually have been pretty strict about not having individual conversations with vendors to this point,
right?
Because we don't want to do anything to prejudice the process, the procurement process, as we move forward. But like Wanda said, I mean, I would imagine that anybody who's in this space will be interested in the RFPs that come out, and we will get some really good thinking from those folks that have been doing assessments all along, including College Board and ACT.
Right.
Hi, I'm Yan Zheng from Boston Public Schools. I'm wondering how this test is going to address English language learners. About 40% of Boston Public School children are English language learners or were formerly English language learners. And the state has agreed, along with linguists and researchers, that only at English language development level 3 do students start accessing the curriculum and academic language. So at ELD levels 1 and 2, how are we going to ensure that the students can access the test and the curriculum and that you are actually testing the content and not English? And especially if teachers are going to be now graded on this test and the performance of their students, I mean, how are we going to make sure that the teachers working with the students and teaching them English in and of itself is going to be accounted for?
I'll let Wanda answer that first. No, listen, both ELLs and special ed are present challenges, and we have technical committees and we'll be developing more committees that include ELL professionals and folks that represent and teach special ed so that we can figure out the answers to those questions. I don't have answers yet, but I can tell you that those questions are very much top of mind.
Are you then going to require students at ELD levels 1 and 2 take the test since it is?
It's too early to know.
But may just a follow-up. Is it fair to say that unless these issues are resolved consistently across all the states, there really is no comparability across the assessments?
Yeah, no, they have to be resolved, I think, and I think we know that. Yeah.
And also, just as we have to do now, that's a federal requirement of when to test students for ELL. I also think that one of the populations that's going to be really helped by having an assessment tied to common standards across the country is our migrant population, because now as students move in the migrant world, they a lot of times they don't take anything with them, and now we'll be able to track progress on standards.
Will this abolish the MIPA, which does actually assess language? And also, there is also a consortium called WIDA that many states have adopted that just test English.
We're part of WIDA in Maine, and I know that they're working to do on this as well, around moving to the Common Core. Again, it's the federal regulations that tells us when we can, when we have to assess students of ELL. How they'll handle this transition is also in transition because of that.
Actually, Mike raised this point earlier, both on accountability and a lot of these more specific questions. There is a pretty major role that the federal government plays that we certainly hope will be addressed prior to field testing of these assessments, or we are really, really going to confuse the field. And I think that the department is well aware of that. And so I think we all hope, for the sake of both implementation of the Common Core and the success of these assessments, that the federal government do what they need to do to address some of these inconsistencies. Otherwise, the transition is going to be really hairy and will not serve any of us well.
Hello. Titus Dasramidius from Strategies for Children and the Early Education for All campaign here in Massachusetts. I have a question for Wanda. We've seen that the PARC Consortium will develop K-2 formative assessments in English, Language, Arts, and Math. Given the fact that we have K-2 Common Core standards now, and given the importance of measuring early learning before third grade, what is the SBAC, the Smarter Balanced strategy for assessing learning or supporting teachers during these three early years of schooling?
Again, that's in discussion. That's the one thing we've been kind of looking at PARC. Well, they're going to do it. What are they going to give? And maybe we'll share. But our folk...
We can make a deal.
Yeah. That's we think there's going to be good trades.
She didn't say
but
deal. She said share.
We don't want to duplicate. We want to give maximum amount of resources. But what we have where we see the K-2 is in more that formative and interim, some of the teacher-developed and materials there, as opposed to it being one of the formal summative assessments in Smarter Balance. We've come a long way. I think we both say we've really come a long way. It's only been since August that we've been working on this. So there's a lot more to come, and I know that there's talks going on between both of our groups to see where we don't have to duplicate and waste money.
Hi, I'm Mike Bronder from It's Learning. And I guess my question is for the whole panel, when you talk about adaptive assessments, are you thinking at this point strictly in terms of text-based assessments, or when you start talking about adaptive assessments, do you start bringing thoughts at this point in of multimedia or different modalities that different students might be able to respond to in different ways?
We aren't looking at one just paper, like just putting a paper pencil thing on the computer. We do want to bring in a lot of different avenues or to so students can access and can connect to it. The bottom line is going to be the bottom line is as to how much, and that's just I think sometimes our eyes have been bigger than our stomachs in terms of coming to the table and to dine. But we are, that's why I think we spend a lot of time looking at what states already have and can contribute so we can make that dollar go further and then do some of the, it's not, if we just put paper pencil up on the computer, then we haven't created anything really new except that it's adaptive now. We need to use all of the digital resources that are there to help us.
That's definitely an active discussion that's happening in Park as well. Especially when you're looking at some of the through course exams where they're more performance based, being able to watch, you know, to watch a video, to see a couple of different pieces of research, and then to write a argument paper grounded in the research that you've been presented, for example. I mean, I think there are active discussions about how we use multimedia and the assessments both to give kids information in different ways, but then also to engage kids in different ways that we know they're currently engaged. So, but Wanda is right, and I'm actually surprised that nobody else has asked the question about cost. Cost is definitely going to be a factor, and it's something that I think we want to be innovative, we want to create innovative assessments, but cost is a reality, and that balance, that balancing act is going to be a tough one. To the extent technology is out there that it can actually save us money, that's, you know, obviously, or not cost us anything more than what we would be creating otherwise, we're absolutely really open to that, and we know it's how kids are engaged and learned, so we would like to figure out ways to use that.
And another advantage is actually we've gotten a lot of foundations coming to us saying, you know, we'll help, we'll, what if we contribute to do this so that we can really have a quality system.
I would just stress the importance of, and I'm sure both of the groups have some form of this, the importance of having a process where teachers vet whatever
Absolutely.
The end result is,
Absolutely.
Because they in the end will be able to say in many ways what is doable in a classroom on an ongoing basis.
Yeah, teachers will be involved, I think, for both of us, and development too, like actually sitting on development committees and certainly heavily involved in item review. Before and piloting before anything gets released, really important.
My name is Rachel Green. I'm from the Boston Public Schools, and my question for you is this: will this, all of this, help students to be more engaged in school? And I'm just going to give you a couple of examples of the students I'm thinking of. I'm thinking of the student who's achieving past grade level and is really engaged and not feeling challenged. I'm also thinking of the student who's incredibly anxious and who sits quietly in the back of the room and doesn't talk. The student who's really angry and gets kicked out of class on a regular basis. And the student who's not attending school frequently because they're at home taking care of a sick sibling, someone else, and aren't able to get into the classroom.
So I'll take a shot at that. I would say that the standard for each of those kids should be the same, right? So that's one of the challenges that we have often in education is we change the standard based on the challenge that the student has. And the exciting thing about the Common Core is that it maintains rigorous standards for all students. I think the challenge for us as practitioners, as district-level officials, as principals, as teachers, is providing the supports for the various groups of students to meet those challenges. When I talked about academic rigor, I defined it as high expectations. That's where the Common Core State Standards come into play. High relevance. I think there's an element of Common Core State Standards that speaks to relevance, but I think it's also one of the challenges of effective teaching. And then the third thing was appropriate support, right? So I'm still learning the Common Core State Standards, and it will be interesting to see how they speak to, or the assessments speak to, the various challenged populations, special ed population, ELL population. But the fact of the matter is, if the expectation remains the same, then the support has to be differentiated. And that becomes a district responsibility, a school responsibility, and a teacher responsibility. And that's something that we're already doing, but we have to do a lot better to meet the various populations that you just referred to.
I think we may be out of time. We need to go to closing remarks.
5 more minutes.
Okay.
So more questions? 1 to 2 more questions.
Good morning, Jenny Thrash from Roxbury Community College. I'm glad to hear that you're adding the component of community colleges in there, because many of our students, as you know, are not going on to a four-year institution. And we are mandated by the community colleges in the state of Massachusetts to administer the ACCUPLACER. So it will be a challenge at the community college levels in terms of how we're going to do this. My question to the panel, anyone on the panel, is what investment you have from industry. You speak about college to career. You seem to have engaged the colleges, either higher ed or community colleges. What about the employers, the industry themselves? What are they saying? And will they be at the table as part of the development process?
So a couple of things. One, we know from the research that actually Achieve did back in early 2000 for the American Diploma Project, and then more recently with the Common Core, that when we asked college professors what it was they expected students to know and be able to do, we didn't actually see much of a difference between what we heard from community college professors of English and language and other first year, or English and math and other first year courses, and 4 year institutions. So we have never actually, when we say college, it's a shorthand for any kind of post-secondary experience. It's a dangerous shorthand, I'll admit that. People get confused about that. We're not talking about 4 year college for all. But it's an important thing to keep in mind. We have always had, and it was true of the Common Core development too, we've always had community college professors in our feedback loop, because we think that's an important thing, and we will continue to. We have a whole higher ed strategy as part of PARC. If you're interested in getting involved, let me know. We have folks from all 25 states that are already involved in that. Those include 2 and 4 year institutions. We think that's really, really important, because that's our goal. On the career side, I would say that what we've been talking about, because we know the reality is that most students will need to have some post-secondary experience to have access to good jobs, that we think everybody needs to be ready for that post-secondary education. So we've really been talking about academic readiness and an ability to go without needing remediation to 2 or 4 year institutions or to a 1 year certificate program or whatever. While in Achieve's broader work, we have had a lot of engagement with the employer community, I would say with respect to this assessment, our engagement has primarily been with K-12 educators and with higher ed, and less with industry. Because I think what we are mostly focused on here with college and career readiness is an ability to make that leap from 12th grade to your next step, which almost certainly will include additional education and training. And that's, it's not to say that the career piece of it isn't important, it's really important, but for this assessment, it's the academic piece of that alignment, and I actually think there's more that it takes to be ready for post-secondary success, but at least with respect to the assessments, that's the focus.
I think we've got one last question.
I'm Tom Fortman, formerly on the Board of Elementary and Secondary Education. Sandy mentioned supporting educators in the classroom. Wanda mentioned tools and practices. Mike mentioned ensuring that teachers have the training and other things that they need. But it wasn't until we got to Irwin that anybody used the C word, that is content, which is part of the instructional core, correctly identified. So my question is, we know that there are serious deficiencies in content among teachers. Most especially, the one that I'm most familiar with is mathematics at the K through 8 level, where the deficiencies in content overshadow any deficiencies in instruction or curriculum or anything else. So my question is, to what degree will the supports for educators that are being considered include addressing content?
One of the, on the slide, and when you see the more detailed one, it might be there, on those modules that we're going to be developing and putting up in terms, so that are public access, kind of the modules around, it could be on number sense for operations or some math concept or ELA concept, that the module be up on the website so that a teacher or student could go on and look at it and get some of that content. One of the things we did, we have a transition to the Common Core work group, and we've surveyed all of the websites across the country to see what is there in terms of transition. And what we did see in a couple places was, and I think they were actually Park States, was modules for math teachers or ELA teachers on how to teach the standard and what the content was behind the standard. That is a big focus of ours as a consortium, but it's also a big focus within the state, because we also have a responsibility within our states to make sure that the teachers who are teaching do have the content knowledge. So there'll be resources up to do it, but I think the responsibility lies with us as state people. And I guess I'm the only state person up here, but to make sure that our teachers that we're licensing do know the content before we do that.
Yeah, and it's a great question, and I think this is an area where Massachusetts can really lead. The question is, you know, why has Massachusetts been so successful? What's led you to you know, move the needle? Certainly the standards and the assessments, but you could also argue that the much tougher teacher test that you put in place was critical, and on the other end, the high school graduation test. And so I think it's also important that we remind the other states that you get the assessments right and you do all the curriculum stuff, that's important, but it might not be sufficient, and that some of these other pieces were critical to the Massachusetts success story too.
So I think we're done, but I want to, before we close, I want to turn over to Jill Norton of the Rennie Center, and as she's walking up to the podium, thanks Sandy, Wanda, Mike, and Irvin.
I also want to thank Jim Pizer for moderating our panel. And the Commissioner Chester, who had to leave early. And I want to thank all of you for being here with us for the second in our three-part series looking at implementation of the Common Core. And I, again, want to thank our sponsors for making it possible for us to be here, Nellie Mae Education Foundation, Intel, Pearson Evaluation Systems, and Fidelity Investments. And so, as the Commissioner said, we are at a time of unprecedented opportunity, also a time where we have a lot of challenges to overcome, and as Sandy framed them, challenges in implementation, technical challenges, and challenges in policy, all of which we'll be looking at in the coming months and years. And so I just want to invite all of you to join the Rennie Center and Massachusetts Business Alliance for Education for our third and final forum of this year, at least, which is June 14th. You have a save the date reminder in your packets. I hope you'll mark your calendars. That's where we're going to be delving into some of these questions that came up on the panel about what does college and career ready mean? Does it mean the same thing? And how are we going to deal with this alignment between our K-12 system and our higher ed system? So we hope all of you will join us on June 14th for that forum. Thanks very much. Oh. sorry, I didn't do my job. One last thing. Please check the website. All of today's proceedings were captured on video and will be available on MBAE's website and on our website in the coming week or two. Also, longer PowerPoint presentations from Smarter Balanced and from PARC. Thank you.